that will be there Sunday, sitting in Serendipity one night, when we went, sat down, ordered some ice cream, which no one should have seen me eating to begin with. And there were a group of young men at the next table, and one said, "What are you doing April 17th? The other said, "I think I'm going to Carnegie Hall." Oh, you're "May I just please have a cup of black coffee?"
Well, listen, everybody wants to go to Carnegie Hall. And, you don't even have to practice, right?
That's what you think. Oh, gosh, I'm practicing more than ever.
All right, well, we'll find out about all these nice things after we hear Martina Arroyo. A very recent recording made when? Last year?
Oh, a couple of years ago.
A couple of years ago. And, well, I think you'll recognize the aria. Just lovely. Martina Arroyo as Mimi. Martina Arroyo, our guest today, and she will be your host at Carnegie Hall if you're there Sunday evening for your first recital in how long here?
Oh, more than 4 years, must be, because the last one was at Avery Fisher, I believe, the last recital.
Mm-hmm.
That must have been about 6 years ago.
Yeah, that's quite a time.
Not really, I'm not a year older.
Well, that's possible, but we've missed you nonetheless.
Oh,
you have been,
yes,
tell us, you know, fill us in on what you have been doing.
Well, almost everything. I've been singing all over the world, and including places like South Africa, which was quite an interesting experience. Yes, a number of people I know have asked, why did you go to South Africa? But, and I have a reason. I know more now why I went than before going. It was an incredible experience. We went to integrate the Pretoria Opera. It was not in any way... It had nothing to, it was no political trip or anything of that sort. The opera was integrated, the chorus, the orchestra, the public, completely integrated. We did recitals. I went to Soweto and worked with and sang for the young people there, who also came to Pretoria for the first time, saw their first rehearsals and performances.
Mm-hmm.
So that after going there, I met so many people, black and white, who said thank you for coming, because so many people have felt so isolated. So many young artists that said, won't you come back and teach? People don't want to come this far, and people don't want us, and things like that. That was painful, because we're still talking about human beings. We're talking about people that also need music as a part of their life, and that's extremely important. You know, I didn't go to Sun City and that commercial stuff. This was really to integrate the opera.
Is there a possibility for a young black artist in South Africa
to get
operatic training and opera?
Yes, as a matter of fact, Mimi Kürzer, who was very well known in Vienna, is South African. And she went back to teach, as did Emma Renzi, who used to sing for years at La Scala. Many singers that we don't realize are South African, Napier and Marita Knobel, that are singing in Germany and Austria, that don't, all over Europe, and certainly some in America, that you just don't, you're not aware that they're South African, and they don't volunteer the information necessarily. And I was surprised to meet Ms. Kurtze there, who was charming and told me about some of her students. I heard some of them. There's one young black African girl, who coloratura, who's being pushed very hard with a beautiful, beautiful talent. And then I'm referring to one because that's the one that I've heard about, but there are many others. I met a lot of young people, white and black, that are just perhaps not technically ready to come out yet, but that are working. But don't have very much opportunity there. And if you hear someone say, but nobody wants us, you know, that's such a terrible thing. I remember when I was a very little girl, I'd heard my own people say that, and this was in New York, you know, not South Africa.
Well, listen, I remember on this program, sitting precisely where you're sitting, and this was maybe 5-6 years ago, we had a conversation with William Warfield.
Yes.
And I asked him what I thought was a simple and perhaps naive question, how is it that he never really sang opera, that he always worked oratorio and concerts and recitals and so forth? And he told me that when he was growing up, there was no point for a black man to study opera, because where was he going to sing it?
And not only that, you stop and think a little bit more down to earth. A man who might think in terms of marrying and having children and being the breadwinner of a family wants a security, or some sort of security for his future. You know, it's not like he'll have the opportunity as many women would. Well, I'll get married, have children, and have a home. I'll try this.
Yeah.
You know, so that if you feel that you're going to be rejected, from the outset, you're not going to even put in the effort. And we know that in this career, you not only put in time and money, but it's very sacrificial. And
what is the situation today, as far as you have gathered it in your travels? Is there still a color line? Is there still a barrier? Is there still prejudice within the opera house?
You know, Bob, I never had that problem. I always went and felt that if there was a problem, it was their problem, not mine. I mean, I couldn't change my color, and if they didn't want me, they shouldn't have invited me. So I never felt going in that, oh, this is a problem. I think that that's using energy in the wrong direction. Put your energy into being positive about your approach, being prepared. This is extremely important. This idea of they didn't want me because I was black, you should all first think that they didn't take me perhaps because I wasn't ready. Was I as ready as I should have been? Mm. And when one can then honestly face that they're perhaps as prepared as they could have been, then you can consider the other possibilities. My last possibility would be my color. Because especially today, for goodness sakes, there's so much that can be done with makeup. And if this is important, this is the same question in a funny way as why does a singer have to be fat? And Lord knows I've battled that problem for years. I've lost about 3,000 pounds and gained about 4. But costuming is extremely important. You cannot put a gown of frills and on someone my size or some of my other colleagues. You know, how you look on stage, how you present yourself is extremely important. It's become even more important in the last years. So that how you look in makeup is the same thing. If you can make yourself up to look the character or be made up, because they're specialists with this sort of things in the bigger opera houses, be made up to look the character, fine. How many 15-year-old Japanese girls do you know that sing Butterfly?
Well, that's absolutely right. Absolutely right. All right, we are going to turn from one of your most recent recordings to an earlier disc dating when?
Remember when you made this? 1969, when I was about 3.
Well, yes, that's what
yes.
I
mean.
No, what's a recording? And you said something before we went on the air that I'd like you to repeat about being able to learn from someone like Carlo Bertozzi.
Oh, well, it's one of my favorite recordings because it was an opportunity to work with Mr. Bertozzi. And may I tell you, I learned so much from that man. And just a year ago, we sang a Verdi Requiem together in California. And I'm still learning from Mr. Bertozzi. He still knows how to turn a phrase like no one. I'm not saying that you don't learn from others. You certainly do. But this gentleman still has that quality, and he's still such a fabulous human being that you want to learn from him. You know, nothing has changed. And I sang my very first Aida in Vienna with him, and he was exactly the same. That was something like 1961 as he was last year, 1982.
Well, I would imagine that people must say exactly the same thing about you. I mean, you seem, at least you seem to me, such a warm and easy and friendly type. I mean, you don't lose your temper ever, do you?
I'm glad you're not asking anybody else this question, because I can easily say, oh, no, I'm a darling. But don't go and ask anybody in the household, I'm sure.
I see. All right, well, let us listen to Martina Arroyo, this time as Leonora. The second act of La Forza del Destino, beautifully recorded once again by our guest today, Martina Arroyo. This time, Lamberto Gardelli conducting. It was Heinz Eichhorn before, didn't mention
that's
that.
That's right, Kurt Eichhorn.
But we should have Kurt.
Sorry.
And with that, we're going to take our first intermission here. We've gone almost half an hour already and haven't had a single commercial, which we'll not do. But after that, we will find out all about Martina Arroyo's upcoming recital Sunday night, Carnegie Hall. We have to go too far away to hear Martina Arroyo in her first New York recital in some 5 or 6 years. It's Sunday night at Carnegie Hall. Martina, what's it going to be?
Well, I'm hoping that there will be some that will stay over from Leontine's concert in the afternoon and just sort of have a quick snack and come in to hear a Mozart concert aria, Bella Mia Fiamma, then some Schubert songs, followed by Ernani and Volami, some Strauss songs, some the Rodrigo Canciones Amatorios, and then we're going to end with Vienita Fretta. if I'm still standing, that is.
If you don't mind, then mixing up opera and concert pieces or leader in a single
Ordinarily, we wouldn't. Ordinarily, it would, a leader program, especially in Europe, would be all leader and without any operatic arias. But I was asked, since I was returning to New York after a few years' absence, to include operatic arias, because I was known for that here. And also, you know, surprisingly, when we go out to universities and other parts of the country and to concert series, we're very often asked, would you please sing an aria, preferably one that that everybody knows, like Un Bel Di. And even without orchestra and being out of context, people do like hearing the arias.
Well, it is true. When people come to hear an artist whom they love, then they love all those aspects, and they'd like to get as many of them as they can.
Used to hearing them sing. And not only that, you know, the recital world, unfortunately, has had a little change about. You have very many fewer recitalists. As when I was coming along a few years ago, you could go to one recital after another: Seefried, Schwarzkopf, Hermann Prey, Fischer-Dieskau, with all recital music, no operatic arias at all. And the houses were sold out. And now, whether it's because people are staying home more for television or don't want to come out at night in some of the bigger cities, but the recitalists are fewer and fewer. You hear many more opera singers singing recitals.
Who is your pianist, by the way?
Henry Venanzi, a young man from Cincinnati, who works with the Cincinnati Opera, with the conservatory there, who's accompanied many singers throughout the United States. Mm-hmm. Very fine pianist.
Martina, we've known each other so long that I don't feel too guilty about asking you an embarrassing question.
I weigh 150 pounds and I'm 24 years old now. You take it from there.
No, that wasn't the question.
Oh, okay.
Try again. No, the thing I am wondering about is your, let's say, non-inclusion of anything by an American composer. I wonder if if you had thought about that, or whether
that was not intentional. It wasn't intentional. As a matter of fact, when we were planning the program, we were trying to put together as fine a program as we could, and we started out with composers and then eliminated, and really didn't say one group French, one group Spanish, one group German, two arias. We just picked out the music that we thought was the nicest music and put as a program, put them together. And oh dear, don't say that, because now I'll go home and think about it and change the program for Sunday and everybody will
understand. You don't want to change the program, but no. No, I was just...
That was really not intentional, not at all. Uh-huh. Not at all. On the contrary, it would have been nice to sing. I mean, it's much easier for me to learn English.
Well, I guess that's true. All right, we are going to consider another operatic situation that forced you to sing in non-English. This is another, by the way, another of the new recordings of Martina Arroyo, Cavalleria Rusticana. This was done when?
Well, that was also done a year and a half ago.
Yeah, that's right. February 1, it says.
Was it 2 years, yes?
That's what it says here, right.
Oh, God, time flies. Yeah.
How do you like the recording process? Do you enjoy the studio puttings together, or do you prefer the straight out singing in the concert?
I prefer the straight out singing, to be honest, because you get into a character and you keep the intensity going. It's so difficult when someone says we're going to take a bloop from here and a bloop from there, and you know, how about four bars from take 97, and you go, no, take 97. Oh my God. On the other hand, there are I have colleagues that have recorded so much and are such good recorders that they know exactly. They'll say, take the cadenza from 24. A, and then take the last note, but put in the high note from 27C, and I'm sitting there going, what's 27C?
Yeah. But do you find that you have to somehow sing differently in the studio, project differently, produce the sound differently in any way?
I don't. I try to sing exactly the same way, and if there's something that has to be adjusted in terms of the mechanical part, I leave that up to the technicians. Mm-hmm. Because if you start playing around like that, you're playing around with your vocal technique, and I'm not so sure that that's a good idea. Perhaps had I done more recording, I could answer that and better. But I haven't recorded that much, really. You'll have to ask Cheryl and Placido and Montserrat those questions.
All right, well, I'll try to remember to do so. Meanwhile, we will dip into Cavalleria, as we said, and a duet.
Oh!
very quiet end to a very turbulent scene from Cavalleria Rusticana. Franco Bonisolli and our guest today, Martina Arroyo, Lamberto Gandelli, conducting. All right, time out for our final intermission here, and then we will continue our discussions with Martina. We have a magic name with us, Martina Arroyo. And Martina, one of the things that occurs to me, we were talking about Roberta Flack, who also has a concert at Carnegie Hall, and I'm curious what sort of music you listen to when you don't have to do anything. You're not studying and you're not worrying about a specific part or anything. You just, for fun, put on your records or turn on the radio. What do you like to hear?
Let me see. Night before last, I sat up and listened to Turandot.
Singing?
Not at all, not really. But a month ago, I went down to New Orleans to sing the Immolation Scene, which was quite an experience. My gosh, that Wagner was great. Anyway, we went to Bourbon Street. I was extremely excited about visiting Bourbon Street. And I can imagine what it must have been, you know, the whole atmosphere, the jazz atmosphere, is so different. And I enjoy it very, very much. But there's nothing like sitting quietly and listening to your old Tabaldi records.
Wonderful. Martina, what lies ahead for you? What's cooking after Carnegie on Sunday?
Well, some more touring of recitals, Washington, Chicago, to Kansas City, Albuquerque, all over the United States for a while, and then out to Europe to do something I've never really done. Well, it was before that, L.A. for recital and a masterclass, but to Salzburg to teach at the Mozarteum for 3 weeks. It's the first time. I've done master classes, you know, one-shot things where you either give a two-second advice or someone, you know, picks your brain or something like that for a couple of hours. But this time it'll be working a full day for 3 weeks every day of the week. And I'm looking forward to it. I'm a little bit frightened because it's quite a responsibility to take a young person's career or their potential into your hands, and I'm hoping that they'll get a maximum from it, you know, that they'll at least feel that I've made a step.
I'm very excited. Is this something that you can see in your future? Would you like to teach, do you think?
I don't know. I'd like to remain in, I don't know if that's difficult because I'm still thinking in terms of singing for the next 55 years.
Well, we are too.
I hope so.
Anyway. I certainly don't mean
not that long, but I don't think I'd want to teach voice as a private teacher, but I'd like to work with young people. I love the young people. I love listening to the new voices that are coming along and watching them grow and go through the same growing pains that I went through. And funnily enough, you think you're going to advise and prevent them from making the same mistakes that perhaps you made, but you don't. Everybody has to make their own mistakes, and everyone has to fall and get up. And I think all of us need someone when we do fall to sort of give a hand when it's time to be picked up. And I'd like to be there to help pick up.
Well, that's wonderful.
Pieces, picker upper.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Well, we are going to pick up another piece from your recent recording. This is an aria set, we should say, as opposed to the Cavalleria, which was a full recording. But this has, let's see, we started with Bohème, there's also Butterfly here, and there's a Tosca aria, and Gioconda, and Macbeth, and Aida, more. But we've chosen La Mamma Morta from Andrea Chenier.
il perigo attiva loto e per sé
of the morning, sung by Martina Arroyo. Martina, we had a call just before from a listener who said that she was ready to leave the house when the program began, but then when she heard that it was you who was going to be here, she just had to sit down and listen, and she's still listening.
Oh,
well,
wonderful.
Now you can leave.
Hello.
We're almost finished here. But that's, I think, quite typical of the feelings that a lot of people have about you. And we have missed you. We have missed hearing you here in New York. And, well, the recital, of course, is this Sunday at 8.
8 o'clock.
And, well, a wonderful program. Mozart, Schubert, Strauss songs, a bit of opera with Ernani, Rodrigo cycle, and just wonderful things with Henry Venanzi, the pianist. But now we are getting greedy. We'd like to have you back in opera. So,
I hope that will be very soon. But I'm looking forward to seeing a lot of old friends, and I hope some new ones on Sunday.
Oh, I imagine the place will be jumping with your old friends and you. So, thanks much for
joining us.
It's been a great, wonderful, warm-hearted delight. Back. You're one of our very special people, I think you know.
Oh, thank you very much.
So, with that, we do...